going to transition into the Big Rock topic, which I'm not going to have a lot of jokes and lightheaded things because this is more of a serious topic, so I apologize for that. I'm going to check to see what much time I have to get an idea. And this is intended to be more of a discussion. There's a lot of information on that Google Drive I pointed you to, a lot of resources, a lot of different things. And in fact, I spent a lot of time searching on different methodologies, different theories, and honestly the best thing that I found was from Boy Scouts of America. You know, say what you will about technology and whatever else, Boy Scouts of America knows boys, and they've known them for a long time. So, and this is really part of that. It's not just boys, but you know, all that kind of stuff. So let's talk a little bit about bullying and bullying prevention. And I want to start by defining it a little bit, kind of give you guys an idea of what, for instance, the dictionary that I have defines it as to use superior strength and influence to intimidate, typically to force a behavior or elicit a response, right? Wikipedia, this is from Wikipedia here, bullying is using force, threats, or coercion to aggressively dominate a person or a group of people, usually, repeatedly, and habitually. The key here, and I've seen this in a number of different places, is an imbalance of power. You have somebody who has either physical power, social power, over somebody else. That's what distinguishes bullying from simply two people fighting and colliding, is this imbalance of power. I'll come back to that too. It's a problem. It negatively impacts the target, and negatively impacts the bully eventually. And the important thing to remember is it's not just a phase. It's not just boys being boys. It's not just messing around. It has lasting impacts and negative repercussions for those who are bullied, the targets, is another way to say that, the people who are bullying, and then even for those people who witness and are just standing by. There are a lot of different forms. You've probably seen, heard, or experienced some of these. Verbal, social, physical is an obvious one to see. Sometimes the social ones are more subtle, especially for if you have girls. Girls are more backstabby, gossipy, background kind of thing. Boys have a tendency to be in your face, overt, sometimes physical, but often just, you know. There's also groups can be very dynamic in terms of sort of a clique or a gang bullying against either another group or an individual. Cyber is an obvious one. If it gets to be pretty bad, and there can be criminal behavior involved. It's worth noting that and understanding what that means, and that has there been a law that's been broken? There are a number of ones. Yes, Chris.
So I want to point out that I like the use of the term target over another common term, which is victim.
Okay.
Because what we don't want to do is instill in either the bully the label of you're an abuser, or of the target the label of you are a victim.
Right.
Because that can then continue patterns later on.
Sure. Yeah.
It really is one person targeting another. You address the behavior.
Absolutely.
Further on.
And it's not the person that is the problem, it's the behavior that's the problem. I think that's excellent. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, so let's really quickly talk about a few myths. It's not the same thing as fighting or conflict. It's often not physical. It can be physical, but often it's mental, often it's verbal, often it's social. So again, these are myths. It isn't just boys being boys. It's a serious thing to see and to understand. I like the number four here, kind of tailors to crime has no address. And the same is true with bullying. It happens in varying forms pretty much everywhere, and also to varying degrees. You know, you think my child is going to private school or something. No, it's just going to be a little bit different. I actually have an example of that if you'd like to hear it later. It's not just an urban problem. It happens rural, suburban, urban, pretty much everywhere. There are youth, and sometimes adults, you know, wherever. And it's not that those who observe bullying don't want to get involved. Oftentimes they're also pressured, whether they realize it or not, to stay uninvolved. So a few myths to set aside and realize that those aren't truly the case. I want to start by looking at signs for those who are the targets. If you have a group of scouts, this is kind of what I'm trying to impart to you, what to look for in your scouts and the behavior that you might see. You might see reluctance to join activities. You might see a scout that pretends to be sick or doesn't come out of their tent at camp or something like that, complaining of, you know, kind of psychosomatic issues. A scout that had 20 bucks at the start of camp and all of a sudden has nothing and no candy or camp swag to show for it. Where did the money go? That sort of thing. A scout that shows up and departs at odd times. Shows up really early so he doesn't have to be there with somebody else. Nightmares and bedwetting, kind of an obvious one. I saw this a long time ago actually, a scout that never wanted to leave his tent because that was a safe place. Important to keep that in mind. A scout that doesn't want to use the restroom. We have to be cognizant, I think all of us have taken youth protection, of that restroom is a challenging place sometimes. We have to be very careful about those youth protection issues that happen in restrooms. And if you have a scout that is afraid to use the restroom, there might be something going on there worth looking into and understanding what's happening. Are they nervous around certain other individuals? Anger and aggression for no particular reason, a change of behavior, a change of their, not personality, but sort of their behavior might be a lack of willingness, obviously, to participate. If you lose a scout, not coming to den meetings anymore. Why is that? Is there something else going on? A few others. Comments on being lonely. There is an element of some scouts are shy, especially at the elementary school age, but shyness doesn't always extend. Shyness is one thing. Exhibiting these kind of behaviors is something else. And if you have a difficulty making friends, a scout who's really seems like at one point they're more extroverted and then all of a sudden they're very reserved and they're having difficulty with that friendship thing, that's something to look for. Reluctance to defend themselves. They just kind of sit and take it, whatever somebody throws at them or group of people. Obviously physical marks, bruises, cuts. I need to work on my editing again. Defensive wounds, things like that. Being temperamental, mood for no reason, angry, stuff like that. If you have a scout that will not let go of their pocket knife, maybe they don't feel safe. A scout who blames themselves, all of a sudden they don't have very many friends, or there's an issue with that dynamic. And again, with avoiding certain places, again, the restroom is a great example of that. There might be others, the common area, something like that. Signs and characteristics of the bully. Obviously, somebody who's sort of mean, manipulative. I have a lot of examples in my brain, and I might share some of you if we open up for discussion too, of very manipulative, very smart people who are able to get other folks in trouble and sort of play that puppeteer game. Those who are physical get into fights a lot and kind of seek that out. And again, with the manipulative coercion causing and convincing others to do something that they wouldn't normally do, right? If they have extra stuff, where did your patches go? Where did all this candy come from? What's going on? Stuff that doesn't belong to them. A hat's a great example. Something always gets stolen, it seems like, by one scout to another. Maybe in trouble a lot. Maybe doesn't mind being in trouble. Maybe seeks out the attention from getting into trouble with something. Oftentimes, they'll blame others. They'll take on that victim attitude. Well, it's not my fault. Billy did it. You convinced Billy to do that. Not accepting responsibility kind of falls into that blaming others thing. And this is the cycle of violence thing. They may have been targets at other locations, whether it be home or a different group. And once a person's been a target, they can oftentimes turn around and become the aggressor to make themselves feel better. And then having friends being bullies, sort of a group dynamic, peer pressure sort of thing. And a competitive spirit can pull into it too. Well-connected peers, with their peers, having that most popular kid in school thing can often lead to that. Having that social power. Having a personality that likes to be competitive and likes to dominate. You can probably think of a few people you've met or scouts that you might know or adults you might know that are very dominating. A scout that's on the other end, depressed or anxious, might seek out some domination over another person to make themselves feel better. Kind of ties into having low self-esteem. That's a big one. If for some reason they're having trouble in school, they're not involved in school, they don't have support from home, pressured by their peers, that sort of thing. 60% of those boys who are bullies in middle school have a criminal record by age 24. More likely to be abusive to their future partners, girlfriends, wives, that sort of thing. That's substantial. That's not just a statistical anomaly. This kind of extends that, being aggressive or risk factors, having less parent involvement. This is especially true as they get older. They have more free time. What am I going to do with my afternoon? Well, let's go harass the kid down the street. Thinking that they're better than other people. At this age, we can really instill that we're all in this together attitude, right? Having that impulsiveness, being hot-headed. If you have a scout who has a real challenge following the rules, that would be something to keep an eye on, too. And this kind of goes back to the great debate of things like violent video games and TV shows. Is that tying into that? I don't think there's any hard scientific evidence, but it's worth noting when you hear a youth talk about, you know, the fight, the blowing things up or whatever. Is that something that they're just saying, or is that something that they really think is important? And that may be a risk factor if they glorify violence. Things that do not factor in include location. Again, crime has no address. Same thing here. School size, interestingly. Big schools, small schools, they all kind of seem to have this. And I've seen this. My kids go to school with, you know, maybe a couple hundred other students, and we've had issues, as well as schools of 700 to 1,000. It's size doesn't matter. And gender. I mentioned that, you know, boys tend to have a tendency to be very overt, very aggressive, very dominating. Girls have a tendency, broad strokes here, to be catty, backstabby, gossipy, that sort of thing. Worth understanding that. So, how do we prevent this? If you see something, hold the bully scout fully accountable for their behavior, for their actions. Don't let them have excuses or create excuses for their actions. Try to help that scout develop empathy. This is part of the problem, is they're removing themselves from their target and not being empathetic. If we can instill a sense of empathy, and I'm going to come back to this verbiage a lot, a scout is kind, a scout is friendly, right? If we can instill those things and establish a sense of empathy and help them to have that, that will help to reduce the problem. Helping their families and their peers hold this particular scout who's bullying behavior, hold them accountable for their actions. Don't suggest rationalizations. Don't give them excuses. This is a good one. I like the top one. When you have a discussion with a scout, it's going to come down to discussions if there's an issue, right? When you have a discussion with a scout and you say, look, this isn't okay. Here's the behavior we need to correct. Make sure you have positive reinforcement for when they do something correct, when they are friendly, when they are kind, when they choose not to be dominating. Positive reinforcement is just as important as correcting. Correct in private, praise in public, right? We all learn that at den leader training and wherever else, right? Encourage them to get involved in activities where they can learn to use their power, their competitiveness in appropriate ways, sports. You know, robotics leagues or something like that. Go ahead, Chris.
So, as far as that first bullet point, it's often more challenging to be consistent with positive behavior or positive praise.
Right.
So, it may be helpful to have a plan among the adults first to have maybe somebody who's in charge of watching for positive behavior and the person that we're working with and jumping in with praise.
I like that. That's great. Because as a den leader, and I see this happening potentially a lot in the den setting. As a den leader, you're focused on the advancement that you're trying to accomplish, the academics of it. And now you have this issue where this scout is providing this behavior you don't want. Maybe you have an assistant, right? Who would mark that behavior and say, hey, good job building the Cub Scout. Is there another reason for their behavior? You know, do they need to establish and work on their social skills? Are they having academic issues at school? Is this something to open up with the parents? That sort of thing. It's worth understanding if that's one of the underlying factors.
Another thing that can play into this is that there are chemical, mental, or emotional challenges that that child is dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, once again, where non-judgmental, open conversations with the parent mm-hmm. can help reveal a better way to plan.
Absolutely. It could very well be that our scout is trying out a new medicine, or they're trying to get the right balance, right, and that sort of thing. Maybe the scout doesn't have the medicine they had because they're trying to get them off it. I mean, there's all kinds of things. Maybe they're trying something different. Yeah, good point. Okay, for those who are the targets, it's important that we also support them. And one of the things I want to... Oh, there it is. Bullet point right here I want to pull out first. Should put that at the top. Don't sit the target and the bully down next to each other and just have a discussion. That's not going to work. You want to have a discussion with the bully. You probably want to have a discussion with the target separately. Probably where no one else hopefully can see, although too deep leadership, youth protection, all those things. Don't treat the target like they're a baby and coddle them. The idea is they have this challenge for whatever reason, and we're here to support them. We're here to help them. It's important to listen to them and get their perspective and get the facts from their perspective. What are they saying? What are they feeling? Praise them for the courage they have to try to get through this, because it's, you know, something that's a challenge when you're a target. It's important to ask them what they need to feel safe. Maybe you can't provide that, but maybe you can help them get it, whatever it is. A few examples about that at some point. We'll have story time. Communicate to the other leaders in your unit. If you're a den leader and you know you have this issue, make sure your cub master knows, make sure your committee chair knows, their committee members, so you're not the only one that understands that there is an issue here. So when there's a pack meeting, we don't, you know, sit these two scouts together, or maybe there's a hike or something like that. We can understand, oh yeah, we have to be careful with these two. Make sure that everyone, although be sensitive and cognizant, and it's not becoming a gossip thing, but we should know that there is an issue. Definitely talk to the target scout's parents and let the parents know that there is an issue and that you're working on it. Maybe the parents have some ideas. Maybe the parents have dealt with this kind of thing before. Maybe it's totally new, and it's important that the parents just know that this is happening and that we're working on a solution. If it gets to a point where it's pretty bad, and, you know, especially in terms of a criminal thing, if there are pictures being posted that are inappropriate or something like that, we may need to make reports to our district executive. That needs to go up the chain. Hopefully it never gets to that point. Hopefully. Always follow up too. And this is something that I have experience personally with something happened and we said, okay, we're gonna try this, and nobody followed up. And it just went on and on and on. And when you're a scout, or anybody, if you're anybody and you're a target, you have a tendency to feel alone. And it's important as adult leaders to make sure that the target never feels like they're truly alone. We're there with them, they're on their side, we're gonna try to fix this, make this better. Why is it important? We're creating a safe environment for our scouts, right? We want our scouts to be a team, we want them to be welcome together. Experts say that we have a new youth, they may become a target. In fact, I have an example of that. We'll come back to this in just a second. So when I was a Weebelow scout. I started as a wolf, right? This was 30 years ago. We had 7 scouts in our den. And we went wolf, bear, with all 7. And then I think it was 5th grade, we were Weebelows, and we lost one. His parents moved to Salem. I'm from Corvallis originally. His dad got a new job at a bank, so we're down to 6. And about that time, a new Cub Scout came in, and he got assigned to our den. because we're down one. All the other dens had 7 or whatever it was. And so this new skeleton, I don't even remember his name, but I remember he was chunky, he had a very high voice, and we decided, all 6 of us, to call him Squeaky. Which was, at first we thought was funny. Backstory also, my mother was our den leader, and she was a great den leader. Mom, you're a great den leader. And I remember for a while, we thought it was hilarious to call this scout Squeaky. And at one point, my mom pulled me aside and said, "You're not calling him Squeaky anymore. That's not nice. It's not okay." Okay. And it stopped. And I think she did that with other scouts as well. And what she had recognized is that it had gone from good-natured nickname to it was actually aggressive. It was actually something where we were not being friendly about it. There's a difference between a nickname and something that's being aggressive. And as it turns out, the scout moved out, I think. He wasn't with us for very long, but I remember that distinctly. So as a den leader, as a cub master, you can have a big influence, and a few simple words can make a huge impact. We're not doing that anymore. That's not okay. The scout is friendly. Huge impact. But do you have any similar stories or any experiences you want to share? Go ahead, Dan.
I had a tough one. I had 2 brothers who are, one was in my den, and his older brother, who is also, he's a weeble, so it was Wolf and Weeble.
Okay.
And we were in a group thing. We'd come to go do some cleanup in the scout shed, and the families had come. And then the boys went off. And later, I found out, I didn't find out that night,
right.
But I got a call from the one of the other kids' parents that said, they had taken, the 2 brothers had taken the younger guy, the smaller guy, and basically shoved him in a trash can and held the lid shut.
Wow.
So I had to go address that. I immediately got both sets of parents involved separately, and said, I want a meeting with both sets of boys, but separately.
Right.
So I went and I talked to the boys who did the bullying event, and I said, "We don't do this in scouts, and this is not acceptable. And if you'd done this in school, you guys could get kicked out."
Yeah.
And but it's going to be a one-time thing. We're never going to do this again. And you are going to stay in scouts, and we're going to do good things. We're going to work together as a team. And you understand this was wrong, and it was hurtful, and it's just not going to happen again, and we're just going to put this aside, and we don't ever have to talk about it again, but it won't happen again. Mm-hmm. And then I went and talked to the other scout. And later on, the parents told me that they were ready to pull out scouts altogether,
okay.
Because they felt that there was some stuff going on at school, too, that I also didn't know about.
Right.
And it totally changed their mind. They have their second son is also in scouts now. You know, they stayed with the den. I haven't had any issues again. It was exactly that. They did not have the 2 boys confront each other, told them separately that it was a done deal, it's over. They both knew that I talked to the other ones, and that it will just never happen again. And that, so I think it went well.
Did you get a good narrative from the target?
I did, yes. He was glad he was still a scout.
Good.
The target did, and felt safe coming back and being, and he hasn't missed anything, and it, we just went on and we were able to nip that in the bud. So
well done.
Yes, I felt horrible.
Yeah, and you do, right? Because you feel like it's on your watch.
I felt it was on my watch, right? You know, and I just happened to be that the boys had gone off while we finished our planning for the meeting and stuff, and I found out about it later. Yeah, it was a tough thing.
Another point to make there is that it can happen quickly, right? You feel like your back is turned.
It's like 10 minutes. Right?
You're doing a thing, you come back. Okay, we're done. Let's go. And if somebody hadn't said something, you'd never know, right?
And they didn't say anything until later. I mean, it was the next day that I got a call from the parent telling me what happened.
Yeah.
So,
Anybody else? Anything to share? We got a longer one. I was in 7th grade. This isn't a scout experience, but this I want to make this point because there are a couple of points in the slides I can reinforce. 7th grade in my school, we have 7 periods. 2 of them are electives. I was a band geek. Yes, I'm a band geek, so one of my electives was band. And for some reason, I didn't choose the wood shop one that all my friends were doing. I chose to take drama for my second elective. And drama was a mixed 7th, 8th grade class, probably about 25 students, something like that. And our first assignment, I have no idea why I did drama, to be honest. I'm not a drama person. Our first assignment was a monologue. And so I memorized this monologue. I can't remember what part of it was. But it was basically a passage about somebody that has Alzheimer's or whatever. And I slipped up and said, oh, he has amnesia. And this gaggle of 5 or 6 eighth graders decided they were going to call me Amnesia Man all year long. And at first it was, whatever, fine. But it got to be, over a few week period, more and more aggressive. And at one point I was like, I told my mom, I'm like, this is stupid. She's like, oh, we know the art teacher. She's a friend of mine at the school. It's middle school. Let's go ask her what you should do. I don't know why she thought the art teacher would be the right person to ask. Whatever. Art teacher says, own it! Amnesia Man! Turn it into a positive. Okay. So I try. At the same time, the drama teacher, about a week later, when I'm doing this Amnesia Man thing, asks me, you want me to stop this? I said, no, I like it. I'm working with it. Right? Turns out that doesn't work. They thought it was hilarious. They kept harassing me. And at some point I realized owning it wasn't going to work, and I shrunk back into, crap, can I live out the rest of this year? Because they're in eighth grade. If I can make it to the end of the year, I'll be fine. And my middle school split to two different high schools, and they were going to different high schools. So if I just survived. And it went on. And on and on, because nobody followed up and nobody asked the question, is this still a problem? Is this still something that you want me to not stop? Until at the end of the year, my dad stopped by and talked to the teacher and said, what the hell's the deal with this Amnesia Man thing? He said it was fine. That was 8 months ago. And at the end of the day, you know, I'm a normal human. I survived. Everything's fine. But it really sinks in my head that when you have something happen, to follow up and make sure that it's not continuing to happen, that it's not a systemic issue. And to give good advice, too. And really what, especially those youth in that, my story there, were looking for was reaction. And I gave them a reaction. I gave them exactly what they were looking for. And now, if my boys come to me and say, Dad, what should I do? I'm going to say, nothing. You don't give them anything. Because what they're looking for is any kind of reaction. That's what they're after. Other stories?
I'm glad you remember that story, Mike.
As long as you're not going to call me Amnesia Man, I'm good. Other stories to share? Thoughts? Comments? I'll wrap it up here. Because we're 8:10. 5 more minutes. Okay. Back to this slide. Individual factors, temperament, social competence, condition if the scout's overweight, if they have another language, if they've got special needs can factor into these things. Other perceived differences, perception, disabilities, all kinds of stuff can play a part. So be aware of those if you have a scout that comes in or is part of your group. Anything that makes them different is going to potentially yield something possibly, so worth being aware of. Identify those youth and take measures to help ensure that they're smoothly integrated into your den, into your unit. And hopefully that makes a lot of sense, that we're welcoming as a group, all that sort of stuff. Support and empower those who are bullied. I'm not going to read every single one of these things. I can come back to this. Keep open the lines of communication with your parents, with your other leaders, so that everyone knows what's going on. Talk to the scouts that are not being receptive to the new scout. Figure out how to help them welcome the new scout. Do activities that pull everybody together, but not in a confrontational way. Set an example. Set an example of being friendly, of being kind.
Yes, Chris. So I had a scenario similar to this years ago with a Boy Scout.
Okay.
Where we had most of the boys in the unit were very active, sports, beefy boys.
Okay.
And we had a couple that were music, video game, not outdoorsy.
Mm-hmm.
And I could, there wasn't any bullying going on, but I could tell that there was a schism there, and there's potential, right?
Mm, okay, yeah.
And so one of the things that I did in some of our meetings is that it took a lot of homework to find out about all of the boys, mm-hmm. so that I could draw connections.
Okay.
What's something that the beefy boys admire that is a strength in these?
Okay.
And how can I set up a scenario where they can rise and be the expert?
Interesting.
What are some unlikely common interests that mm-hmm. we can plan an activity around?
Yeah.
And coincidentally, everybody liked it.
Okay, cool.
There was a lot of behind-the-scenes work that I went through to set up these spontaneous moments where they could make connections.
Right.
It worked because we never had any bullying from that group.
Very cool. Yeah. It took a lot of, I'm sure it did take a lot of research and time on your part, but that's a great example of how to pull a group together who may have different interests, but underneath the surface there's always something. If you see something, take it seriously. I always like to say things like, a scout is kind, a scout is friendly, and reinforce those points of the scout laws that we're all trying to espouse and we're all trying to live up to every day. And sometimes we do better jobs than others. That's the nature of this life that we live. And make sure that you let your scouts know that the behavior is not acceptable. Do your best to keep an eye as best you can on those in your care. If you go to camp, you know, don't just go take a nap for 3 hours while the scouts are wandering around to activities. Stick with them. And like as Neil demonstrated, you know, it's easy to turn your focus on something else for just a few minutes. It's important to have enough volunteer effort and help with you, even if it's others or their parents, to keep those ears open, keep the eyes open, and keep the radar going. A few resources. I was going to try to pull together a whole bunch of things for you guys. But in reality, there's a lot of stuff here. And what I've done is I've pulled out the flyers. This is the link you'll get this evening to all our handouts. All that stuff is there in PDF format. Lots of reading, things to think about. So those are the resources I have for you. And that's my discussion. Anybody else have anything to offer? Go ahead, Heather.
So you sort of touched on it.
Okay, go ahead.
One of the other really good things that can be done, and this is what they're doing in the schools right now,
okay.
is empowering all of your scouts to also be those eyes and ears, and what they teach in the schools right now is see something, say something.
Okay.
That's it. See
yeah.
something, say something, so that if you, especially if you have a bully who's drawing power from their peers,
mm-hmm.
they lose those peers. They lose, that shifts the power.
Okay.
So teaching all of your scouts, if you see someone getting bullied or someone
mm-hmm.
who's being bullied,
say something,
tell somebody.
And what you're
and
doing,
kids are getting much better at it. That whole like your myth about they don't want to get involved, that's really true, and there's starting
right.
to be a shift because of all of the really horrible things that are happening
right.
as a result of bullying.
Right.
Kids are starting to stand up to support their friends, support their schools, things
right.
that they're like, this is important to us and we're not going to mess around.
And what you're doing at that point is you're breaking the clique. You're breaking the gang, you know, and this. There's a whole discussion that Clark Green had on Scoutmaster CG, if you listen to his podcast, about how 100 years ago, youth had gangs and cliques that they went around. And that's really sort of the essence of the patrol system, is taking that small group and turning it to something good. And some groups are having a hard time making that patrol system work because we've gone to the point of realizing that that's not always a good thing. And that's a great example of that. So thank you. Anything else to add on? There's probably plenty more. Okay. So we did the news, sports, and weather. We talked about the cyber chip. We did about the cyber chip, the HODAG award. We did the point of the scout law. We did a cheer and a game, and we talked about how to prevent bullying. A couple more slides. Upcoming roundtables. Next month, Mr. Crossman is going to be here to tell you all about Leave No Trace principles and outdoor ethics. He is now a Leave No Trace trainer, and I think it's fair to say he's pretty excited about it. And I know he's already working on his presentation, so if that's of interest to you, I hope it is. It's the outdoor code and all those things are in pretty much every rank now requirements, so it's good to understand what those are. And he wanted me to tell you that there's going to be some freebies. I forget exactly what.
It's the
LNT tags, that's it. So there will be swag for anybody who shows up next month. Mr. May is going to be telling us all about derbies, and Mr. May is the only person I know who has successfully pulled off a space derby. Selling point.
Let's say 75%.
By the way, I think that's this match you can actually achieve.
That's true. That's about the size it gets. We're on a curve, right? So June will be Mr. May telling us about derbies. Heather here is going to tell us about all things flag in July, from etiquette to ceremonies to retirement ceremonies. I don't think Heather has started her presentation yet, but I know she's got it. It's all up here. And then August, of course, is going to be the district burger burn. I will be here. I will be supportive, but you're going to have all kinds of other people. So if you're tired of hearing me talk, come the next few months, you'll hear other people yak. And I get to take a break and bring my stuff and support other people to do fun and exciting things. And I get to learn stuff. Sorry, what?
Otherwise known as Mike's temporary retirement.
That's right. I'm on vacation. It's going to be great. So that's what's coming up, and at some point we'll have an announcement of production about what's going to happen for the 2017-18 program year, but that's not going to be probably until July, I'm guessing, or August. So questions, thoughts, comments, all good? Yay? We are on social media. We're on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, sort of, kind of. I should get back on Twitter. We have a website, Connect. New sports and weather. If you have any feedback, I'd love to hear it. I don't have any forms today. I'm kind of running light on my forms, but I'd love to know if there's something that we're doing that we should stop, if there's something that we're not doing that we should start doing, or if you like what we've got, we should continue. Like, hey, did you notice my slides are now 16 by 9?
And they're color.
Do you like that?
Yeah.
I'm using my whole screen. Look at that. Otherwise, thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. Have a great evening. Hi everybody, this is Mike with the end screen. On the top left, you can click and watch part one of this presentation. On the top right, you can click and watch our presentation on boy behavior and den discipline. On the bottom left, you can click and watch our presentation about spring recruitment. And if you're not yet subscribed, click on our logo there on the bottom right and you will be subscribed. It's all good stuff. Thanks for watching.